The blood-brain barrier is a specialized permeability barrier in the cerebral microvessels. So those are the vessels that are lining up the brain. And this is on the right here is a cross-section of one of these blood vessels, which are the smallest blood vessels in the brain, which are called capillaries. And you see here the blood cavity that's enveloped by the endothelial cells, which are the cells that are lining up the actual vessels. And around the endothelial cells, we have the other cells called pericytes, astrocytes, and the neurons, which are supposed to be the target for most diseases, especially neurological and neurodegenerative diseases. So the main obstacle to reach the neurons from the blood cavity is the blood-brain barrier that lies up here, which is similar to what we call the tight junction. This is a specific protein strands that are lining up and are actually linking the endothelial cells, and is the extra defense that the brain has against foreign molecules compared to the rest of the body. So the blood-brain barrier in a normal brain does what it's supposed to be doing, which is preventing 99% of molecules that are greater than a specific threshold, and in this case it's 400 Daltons, to go from the blood cavity reaching the surrounding cells. But in the diseased brain, this becomes a huge problem because the drugs that are available to treat the diseases in the brain, only 5% can cross the blood-brain barrier. So this becomes a main rate-limiting factor in brain drug delivery. How can you actually cross from systemically administered drugs through the blood-brain barrier into the surrounding cells that you want to treat that are affected by disease? So in the case of the diseases that we can actually affect by being able to manipulate the blood-brain barrier, are several. So we have the Alzheimer's disease and the Parkinson's disease. That's a diseases that affect several millions of people in the US every year. And right now they're undertreated, meaning that the drugs that are available are not necessarily treating or even curing the actual brains that are affected by the disease. And you can see that the actual structure in the brain that's affected by those diseases is very deeply seated. It's actually at the hippocampus level, which is right here, very, very deep into the brain. For Alzheimer's disease and for Parkinson's disease, the substantia nigra, which are also right in the middle of the brain. Other diseases that are less common but as devastating, if not more, are the Huntington's disease. Also similar deeply seated structures that are affected, called the striatum, or the ALS, or the amyotrophic lateral sclerosis that affects the spinal cord. So in order to be able to treat the diseases, we have to cross the blood-brain barrier, and we also have to go into these deeply seated structures so that we're able to affect the regions of the brain that are affected by the diseases. There's many different methods that are available to do this for drug delivery, and except for this last one that I'm going to be talking extensively about, which is called focused ultrasound, for the rest of them you have to pick between an invasive procedure or a localized procedure. If you want a localized procedure, the only alternative is to do a direct injection in the brain, and it's called the transcranial brain drug delivery, and it's exactly how you would imagine. It's a small cranial window that's opened, and a needle that is injected into the brain, reaching the subcortical structure in the middle of the brain, for example. And then once you reach that structure, you inject the drug that's going to treat that tissue. So that's the only localized method. For non-localized, but non-invasive as well, so the advantage here is the non-invasive property of this specific methods is chemically tricking the blood-brain barrier to uptake the actual drugs that are available. And for that, there's been a lot of different things that have been implemented. Lipidization involves the addition of lipid groups onto the drug so that they're uptaken by the endothelial cells and into the surrounding cells to be treated. Or you can actually use different solvents and adjuvants to dilate the vessels or contract them so that they can actually uptake the drug of choice. And finally, some endogenous transporters. So you, again, chemically modify the drugs so that they actually enter the transport system of the cells and reaching from the blood into the surrounding tissue. So this, after injection of this drug into the systemically, you're reaching all the entire brain the same way. So you're chemically changing the actual drug molecule and you're affecting the entire brain, normal, healthy, or unhealthy, the same way. Which basically means that you have a non-localized technique. So that actually can have huge side effects, because if you have a drug that, for example, treats Alzheimer's, you may at the same time be causing other effects in the normal brain that you don't want to. So the only currently available alternative to benefiting from both the non-invasive property and the localized property is the focused ultrasound that uses ultrasound waves together with intravenous microbubble administration. So how does it work? We actually have been doing this in mice mainly because we don't find very many human volunteers yet. So you have a transducer which sits up here. This is actually a picture of the actual experiment. We have a water container that ensures coupling between the transducer and the top of the head of the mouse, which sits up here. And the mouse is only basically anesthetized and shaved. The hair is shaved from the top of its head. So we target a specific region of the brain, in our case the hippocampus, which is affected by Alzheimer's disease. We inject the microbubbles intravenously, and then we apply the ultrasound wave. The blood-brain barrier actually opens pretty much instantaneously. And once it opens, then we inject systemically the molecule of interest, being either a contrast agent or a drug. Then we allow the molecule to deposit through the brain region where we have opened the blood-brain barrier. And the main objective is that we can open the blood-brain barrier non-invasively, selectively, so in a specific region in the brain, transiently, so that means that the blood-brain barrier will recover after opening, outside of the MRI system, so we don't need a specific magnetic resonance system to be able to guide our technique. And we can also do just a single sonication or a single application of the ultrasound and open the entire brain region that can uptake the drug. And we have been able to image this with MRI. I'm showing you here the histology of the mouse brain. We utilize the symmetry of the brain, so we always have the control hippocampus on the right and the targeted hippocampus on the left. And we actually show mainly the MRI imaging after the opening of the brain and administration of the contrast agent called gadolinium. And this is an image of the gadolinium after 90 minutes of administration. You can see how the region where the opening has occurred highlights very nicely the hippocampus. That means that the actual contrast, which is actually above the threshold for blood-brain barrier diffusion, can actually reach the hippocampus, while the control hippocampus cannot be enhanced with contrast because the contrast cannot cross the blood-brain barrier in this case, since the ultrasound was not applied on this side. One day later, we actually follow exactly the same protocol, and we're able to see that the blood-brain barrier has closed or recovered. The gadolinium, or the contrast agent, no longer goes into the left hippocampus. So that means that the actual technique is transient. We have also shown this in Alzheimer's transgenic mice. So these are mice that are specifically mutated in order to be able to develop the amyloid plaques, which are actually plaques that are formed in the brain. It's one of the signs of anatomical signs of Alzheimer's disease, and also one of the markers for human Alzheimer's. So you can see those on histology. These are some white spots that are lining up the hippocampus in this case, which are absent in the normal hippocampus. And we see exactly the same type of opening on the MRI image and absent 1 day later. We have also experimented with larger molecules that are more relevant to drug to the drug delivery. So the contrast agent of gadolinium is about 600 daltons, which is very small. Usually the drugs that are available for Alzheimer's disease treatment or other neurodegenerative disease treatment are on the order of several thousands of daltons. So from 1,000 dalton to 200,000 daltons. So we have actually used fluorescence imaging used also dextran molecules that are fluorescently tagged. And we started with 3,000 daltons, which has a diameter of about 2.3 nanometers. And again, on the left side is the exposed hippocampus to ultrasound, or sonicated hippocampus. And on the right side is the control hippocampus. So we see that the actual enhancement of the image, or where the actual image appears much brighter, is where the molecule has actually reached the brain after being systemically administered. And you can see that the entire hippocampus here is lighting up, as opposed to the control hippocampus, which is completely dark. We also go to 70,000 daltons, or about 10 nanometers in diameter, so larger molecules. And we see also a little bit of a less bright region. So that means that a smaller concentration or volume of the drug or of the molecule in question has actually infused in the hippocampus. But you do see it lighting up much more than the control hippocampus, indicating that the actual molecule has actually diffused through the region. And finally, at the largest molecule, which is 2 million daltons, or 2 megadaltons, it's about 20 nanometers, those molecules do not go through the barrier that we have opened. They actually stay in the vessels, and this is actually it's called a hippocampal fissure, and these are the main arteries that are lining up the actual fissure here, hippocampal arteries, and those contain the largest concentration of the fluorescent molecule in this case, indicating that it hasn't actually reached the hippocampus. And those are actually going, these are sizes that are going above and beyond what the available drug sizes are. So this is the limit of what can go through the blood-brain barrier after it's opened with ultrasound. So this is a summary of the looking at the orthogonal plane to the previous horizontal plane. It's called the coronal plane. And what we have here on the left side is the left hippocampus, and on the right side, the control hippocampus. And we have 3,000 daltons, 70,000, and 2 million daltons. And you can see that at 3,000 and 70,000, we are affecting the entire hippocampus using just one sonication. And the fluorescent molecule is actually infusing the entire hippocampus. At 2 megadaltons, the hippocampi are equivalent to one another because the actual molecule did not infuse. And we can also do this in 3D MRI by looking at the infusion of the actual molecule. In this case, we're sonicating both hippocampi. And we can actually see a 3D volume that's affected by the diffusion of the molecule through the blood-brain barrier.